thank you so much for being here and for responding to the invitation to be here. And I will tell you the purpose of the meeting, what it's about, why we're doing this, and how it came to be. But I just want to start off by saying we are going to be having more meetings. So some people were asking, gee, why did I get invited and someone else didn't? We really were trying to mix the groups so that each time we had some sisters who live on the property, people who work on the property, people from Earth Matters, staff members, men who work on the property on the outside. So we really wanted each of the meetings to have some mixture. So we purposely, you might be saying, gee, I was asked in my house, but someone, Sister So-and-so was not asked from my house. So we're trying to be sure that at each time that we have a meeting, we have some more mixture of the people who live on the property and work on the property too, and are connected with us in various ways. So that was part of the invitation. At 3 o'clock, we have another group coming. I'm trying to do some later times with some of the groups so that people who live on the property and work off of the property can attend some of the input sessions. So just as a little background to this, a couple of months ago, the leadership team met with some of our colleagues that I'll be introducing in a moment and talked about a master plan for the land. So we're not talking, these meetings are not talking about the buildings. It's a lovable issue. I'm fortunate not to be part of that. But this is, we're looking at our land initiatives. Some of them you'll be very familiar with, some of the things we have been doing, but also a planning stage for things that need to come, need to still happen here on the land. And how do we integrate all of these initiatives together into one master plan? So we have the leadership team that engaged with two different organizations to work with us. As you know, we've been working with the Peconic Land Trust, and we have two of our colleagues from the Peconic Land Trust, Kim and Dan. They've been here on the property many, many times, and they're part of the master plan. And then we've also been working with a land ecologist, Rusty, and Rusty has been working on many aspects of our land with and for us. And Rusty works for Nelson Pope and his colleague Pat. They do environmental planning. So together, we're hoping to get all of their different skill sets, bring it together in order to help direct us toward a master plan for the land. Kim is going to be doing an initial presentation, and then a very, very important part of today is your input. It's really not about informing you as much as it is for you to give us suggestions and ideas. Your people who live here, work here, obviously have a vested interest in this property. So we really need to have your comments coming back to us. Didn't think of this, or why didn't you think of this, or what are you thinking about doing here, or I think this needs to be included in the projects. So we really are looking for your input at the end of the presentation. So I'm going to ask Kim, who will be using the microphone. Now, just as I say that, I said to all of them, please be sure to use the microphone, and then I stand up and I use the microphone. I know Kim's probably thinking that.
It's just been mowed for years and years on a weekly basis, and we thought, you know, that's not the best use for this property. Let's get this back into production and make it more sustainable and productive. So we've worked with you for the past couple of years to get this in production, or at least 27 acres into production. And we have secured 6 different farmers on site. And these are the farmers that we have leases with for this year. We have Farrah Farms, that's Teddy Balkis, who is working out the very front section there. We have Limpy, which is Rusty Schmidt here. Organic Mosaic, the farm at St. Joseph, the Napolitano Family Farm, and Organics Today. And then we've also been working on farmland preservation because of the fact that this property has prime agricultural soils. We want to see this preserved for agriculture. We want to see a lot of this land preserved so it's there in the future for the next generations. So there's a number of ways to do that, but we had talked about a couple different options, and the one option that we decided to go with was through the sale of development rights to the county under their farmland preservation program. And this is a program that would essentially extinguish your development rights on the portions of the property that we have identified in these areas in the north and the south outlined. It's about 27 acres, and you would have extinguished the right to develop it for commercial and residential purposes, although it can be developed for agricultural purposes. So the county process for something like this, we would submit an application. It typically takes a year and a half, and we're right on schedule with that because we have submitted an application to the county in August of 2016. The offer, they accepted the application, and an offer was made in July of this year for $2.29 million. So you'll be realizing compensation for your development rights. Then in August of this year, the offer was accepted by the sisters, and then the county received the offer and they drafted a contract. Actually, I haven't updated this, but the contract has been signed. So that's back at the county, and now the county will be doing a title search. They'll be doing an environmental assessment and a survey of the property. That's all typical procedure. And then we anticipate no problems and to be able to close by year end. And if it's not year end, I'm sure it'll be January. So we're right on schedule with this. And then we have the wastewater management. So I guess it was about 2 years ago, the sisters received a grant from the Long Island Community Foundation to do a wastewater management analysis. And that was done through Cameron Engineering. And I'm not going to pretend to be an expert on this, but I got these pictures from Cameron Engineering, and they have done an analysis and submitted their report to the sisters and basically identified a new system that would be more efficient, and it would break it into 2 individual systems to service the main house here and then the Maria Regina. Did I say that right? Thank you. So it would just be a more efficient system. And that is being reviewed now, and I believe they're putting that out for bid to contractors. And this is similar to what the system would look like. This is what they're proposing. And if you have questions about this later, possibly Rusty could answer those questions. And then there's the solar array. The solar array is located in the southeastern portion of the property near the wastewater management, and we've identified that as what we're calling the utility area. So the area there has been cleared, and the solar array is currently being installed, and we anticipate that this solar array, once it's up and running, will be able to power 60% of your needs. Then there's the National Historic Registration. And this, again, is a significant property, significant, beautiful historic buildings, and we'd like to see them preserved. So especially the chapel is just so unique and beautiful, and Sister Clara actually kind of spearheaded this project, and she began an application with the National Historic Registry, and they had come out to the site to look at the buildings and realized that it's not just the buildings here, it's the whole property. So the property itself and the buildings are all being considered for designation. information on the registry. The application has been submitted and they keep requesting additional information, but I understand that everything has been done on your part and we're just waiting to be reviewed, which won't be until June of 2018, but that's in process as well.
And Virginia Dowd, who's here at our office, has been working closely with Sister Clara on all the preparation. So if there are questions about that when we're finished, we'll...
It's really in process.
Yes, in the process.
And then we have a rain guard, actually, that was installed by Nelson Pope and Gordon's over by the garage. There was a main area of puddling during storms. We actually have a before and after here, or a during a rainstorm, and the puddling and flooding that would occur. So Rusty came in this summer and designed a rain garden and installed all the plants, apparently on the hottest day of the year. And now this is the result. So when we do have rain, it's filtered properly and we don't have that problem anymore. There's other problem areas on site that we might be doing that in other areas, but this was our first initial try at that, which seemed to be a success. And then there's meadow habitat. As I said before, we have a lot of open space here, a lot of lawn, which might not be the best use to be mowing that every week. So another alternative to that would be a meadow habitat, and that would be more environmentally friendly, and it would foster wildlife habitat, it would act as a pollinator. So we identified approximately 4 acres in the front lawn area here that Rusty designed and had coordinated to have it planted. I think Dan did a little bit of plowing to prep it this past late summer, and it's currently in a cover crop. It wasn't ready yet to be planted in the seed for the meadow, and that will be done in the spring. And then we have, these are proposed projects that we're going to touch on and just give you some ideas that we're thinking about. We'd really like to hear your input on these ideas too, and if you think one is a priority over another, we'd like to hear that too. So we're just going to touch on landscape initiatives, cemetery, the memory garden, the barn expanded uses and restoration, woodland restoration, trails and pathways, orchard, expansion of the organic garden, the labyrinth, stormwater management, memorials, perimeter of the property upkeep, Olmsted plantings restoration, and an overlay easement. Any questions so far? So landscape initiatives, we're just trying to think of how we can better utilize the space and make it more sustainable. There's, like I said, the lawn is a big portion of the property, so do we expand that meadow habitat? Do we make that more of the whole front lawn? Or another option would be something like a permanent pasture, which is also more sustainable. It wouldn't require frequent mowing, but it would also be more productive because you could harvest that, you could use that for the animals that you have, or maybe some future animals. The cemetery, cemetery is an area that has been neglected over the past few years, so there's some beautification needs there, maybe some restoring of these statues and some plantings. There's also the need to address possible expansion or refurbishing the existing plots. So that's something that we need to talk about because we're getting to the end there and we need to know if we need to make room for expansion or if we're going to refurbish those existing plots. We also have the idea of a memory garden, and this is a really neat idea. This is a garden that would be planted for the sisters. It's usually a small garden where there's no end, and there's it's for Alzheimer's patients, and this would promote memory. So you put things in there that are from past generations, because Alzheimer's patients don't have the short-term memory, but they have the long-term memory. So you might have a clothesline out there or some plantings that would revive old past memories, like mock orange is a familiar scent, that sort of thing. So it doesn't have an end, so people wouldn't get confused. It's just a short, small garden, and it's just expanded uses or restoration. So this is, you have a beautiful, amazing dairy barn on site, which is huge and really underutilized. And there's a lot of different options for this. Actually, Rusty had a team of his architects out here to look at the structure and to see what could and couldn't be done there. We actually took some of the sisters on a tour yesterday on the North Fork to see some other barns and to see some multi-purpose uses and get ideas for what we could be doing with that barn. And there are a lot of ideas, but we really need to hear from you what your needs are. And we kind of need to see what's going to evolve from this farming practice. And you do have the organic garden on site here, so you do have your own farmers. There are some needs from farmers that we're leasing property to, and we see that they are asking for storage space and that sort of thing, so it might be a need to be leasing them more space and in that barn. One of the things that we saw at this, one of the tours yesterday, the tour stops, was a barn that had floating walls, and it was pallet walls that were rustic, but they could be moved and used as dividers, and that might be an option for some sort of division in the barn for lease space. But I think this is something that we really need to have it play out a little bit more before we make definitive recommendations. But again, it's an amazing space. The upstairs especially would be great for a barn dance, for fundraising or something like that. And it's just, I just pictured that there.
Swing your partner.
And this is some examples of, you could do cooking classes there, it could be stored, for hay storage that's, I guess, being utilized partially for that, and for fundraising. This is one of our fundraisers the sisters were at a couple years ago. And then there's woodland preservation. So on site here, you have approximately 60 acres of pristine woodland that you just don't see anywhere else on the island. And that's because you don't have a deer population here. So this is really special forest that we'd like to keep intact and preserved. And one of the ways would be through a similar easement, but we'd like you to realize some sort of compensation, like with the County Farmland Preservation Program. There's currently not a program out there that does that. However, we have met with Assemblyman Engelbright, who has received some funding, and we're working with him to structure some sort of a grant that would allow us to protect this woodland with those funds. So that's in process now as well. And another thing we need to address is woodland restoration, because this is pristine woodland and we do want to see it protected. We need to be on top of this. And this was actually, we did have some Japanese beetle invasion here a little bit this summer, and it was caught early, so it was remediated, but we need to stay on top of that and just monitor the woodland and make sure that it's properly taken care of, and if there's any disease or decay, that could be removed as well. And then trails and pathways. This is one thing that we want to utilize to connect all these different clusters of the property. It could be educational trails, we have kiosks up to identify the areas and identify the important features, and just link everything together. And then there's the idea of an orchard. We understand that there was an orchard here on site previously, and has since, some of the trees are still there, but they're not producing, and it's our understanding that that's a definite interest of the sisters here to have something like that again, which is a lot of work, but it can be done. So we're talking about ideas of locating an area for a small orchard or an orchard to line the driveway. And so we've identified an area along the southeastern portion of the circle there near the labyrinth that could be a small orchard, or like I said, just do some lining of the driveway there. It's a possibility. And the expansion of the organic garden, this is something that's already happening through Sister Mary Lou and Heather themselves. It's just been growing and very successful with the community. So they've been adding additional community plots. There's an interest maybe in additional livestock and some fruit trees. There are a few fruit trees that are on the property right now, but we're looking to maybe expand that as well. And then there's the labyrinth. This was installed, a few years ago? How many years ago? Ten years ago?
Well, it was originally done by the Earth Matters Committee, then it was inverted, but then a company came and then fixed it up. So that one is probably, it started the late 1990s, but probably early 2000 that was.
Okay, so I mean, this is a great thing to have. It's a great area for reflection. The only thing we see is it's kind of stuck out there. It's not really close to the building. So we want to make that a little more accessible and maybe beautify it a little bit more, link it to some other components and have some trailways there. And then there's stormwater management. So like I mentioned before, there are some other areas of puddling that would be needed to be addressed on the property. And these are just some other alternatives, tree trenching and a very fancy rain barrel and some additional rain gardens. We'll be identifying some sites along the property where these might be installed. And then there's memorials. So we have this over by Our Lady of Grace. This is a great way to actually not only improve landscaping, but recognize individuals or entities. And it's a source of income. So we want to maybe focus on this and beautify what we already have and encourage more memorials on site. And then there's perimeter upkeep. So this is Dan. This is on the northern part of the property. Some of the areas are a little sketchy near the borders, and we just want to make sure that our borders are safe and secure and also maybe a little more presentable so we're good neighbors. This is near Organics Today was farming in this area, and so the farmer had this idea that he was going to grow up some corn to have a border that would be for safety and security of his crops and also to be more aesthetically pleasing, but as you can see, his corn didn't really grow, but good effort. And then there's the Olmsted planting restoration. So, as you know, the Olmsted plan was originated here. There were plans for this, and the property, the area where this was originally implemented has since fallen away and needs some restoration. This is a huge undertaking, but we have been in communication with a program up in Wasuni students that are willing to come and assess this property and make it part of their programming. So that's something that we could do down the road if you're interested in having this done. It could be done through their programming. They might have to stay here for a semester or whatever, and then they would present a plan for you to implement. And then there's the idea of an overlay easement. And an overlay easement is an easement that we're proposing the sisters would donate to the land trust. And why would you do this? You would do this to protect the entire property and protect the integrity of the property. It wouldn't extinguish all your rights because we would write it in a way that would be tailored for your uses and needs. But it would make sure that your goals are protected. So you could still have the uses and the structures that you have, maybe some additional ones that are not doing yet, but it would protect the property that hasn't been built up yet. And we would be a perpetual steward and a partner with you going forward. So, like I said, it can be tailored, it can allow for additional structures and uses. The one thing is we would request a stewardship contribution because we would be stewarding this in perpetuity with you. And that's really it. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
So the purpose of Kim's presentation is just to say these are the areas that our four experts have designated as what they see could be helpful for us. And that's in them knowing us, knowing our story, knowing this land. Their next job will be, and what we've asked them to do in the master plan, they would then take each one of these projects and work out a plan for the project. So this is just to say at this point, this is what they see could potentially be a project area for this land. We may choose to say, no, we're not really interested in this particular project. And that's where we need some of the input. Where are people saying, these are the things we want to go in that direction? And also, you'll notice that the section, the second part of your paper, it's a numerical order. Because they put it into a priority order. They did this, and they met with the leadership team, and based on the meeting with the leadership team, they have changed the priorities. So they had an original priority order, and now they've changed it based on some input from the leadership team. So you may notice that based on the input from the leadership team, the cemetery was bumped up. They originally had the cemetery on their original plan, was probably number 12 or 13 or so on their list. Well, based on leadership sees at this moment, some of the decisions that will need to be made sooner than later, let's move that cemetery higher on the list of priorities. The same thing with the memory garden. That was Rusty's idea that he had shared with the group, and that was further down. And leadership sees this is something that could be very, very helpful for our sisters and people who are here on this property. Let's move that up on a priority list. So that's kind of what we're looking to hear from the group, what people see as priorities, but to know that not one of these have been fully fleshed out. I think in their minds, they have lots of ideas of how it could happen and what needs to happen in order to make this a reality for us. But that will be the next part of the presentation. Now that you've said, yes, these are the things you want us to prioritize, these are the areas that you see would be part of a master plan, the next step then for the team will be to work on, and these are the steps that need to happen in order for this to become a reality for you. And I do want to say that at this point, as we looked at all of the things that are happening, I really need to give a great deal of gratitude to Steve and to Brian here with us today, because none of these things would be possible without the daily cooperation, passion that they have, and the unbelievable generosity of their time and expertise in Steve, Brian. None of this would be happening if it wasn't for both of them. I know at this point, when Brian sees my car coming onto the property, he's heading the other direction. Here she comes again, another idea. I'm going to ask for our other colleagues here, if you could just introduce yourself and say a little bit of your expertise in working with us, and that will help them as we then try to get some comments and questions. So Dan, just tell us what you've been doing with us.
Yeah, so I'm Dan Hessen, I'm with the guy that I'm also with Kim, and I've been mostly focused on putting farmers on the land and getting the land back into production again. So we've been doing that for the So I think we did want to mention somewhere in here that we are also talking about getting some additional equipment for you guys here. So we went over that with Steve and Brian that we're looking into some farming type equipment. So when we don't have farmers able to farm every bit of it, then you guys will be able to take care of it yourself instead of having us. In the past, I've come in a couple times and planted some cover crops and everything, and that's really not a practical thing for to keep doing. So we did want to mention that we're going to do that. So I think Dusty wanted.
I'm Rusty Schmidt. I'm a landscape ecologist. It's my own title. There's no such thing, really. I'm a landscape architect, and I also went to school for ecology, so I've kind of put the two together. So what I do is I do landscape architecture, but only for sustainability and biology thinking. So it's all about sustainability. And so that's kind of who I am. What I've been doing on the property is whenever Sister Karen calls, I come running. Which means I've been helping out at the solar array, thinking about what are the plants that go underneath the solar array, looking at and helping with the grant for the Southern pine beetle eradication that is in our pine forest, building the rain garden, helping with the meadow, a few other things like that. Then I also have a second hat. I'm also the president of the Long Island Native Plant Initiative, or LIMPI. It's a horrible acronym. But what we do is we are promoting and planting native plants that are in decline around Long Island. We have a founder's plot on the property. It's in the back, behind the straight back here. And we are planting plants that don't have a lot of populations left on the island. And we are taking populations from different parts of the island, planting them together, and improving the genetics of our natural native Long Island plants. So because of who you are and where you are, this is an oasis surrounded by homes. These plants are not getting impacted by other plants from around here. So this is a great opportunity for these plants to really grow up here in Long Island, improve the genetics, and do that. So that's the other part that I do. So I'm kind of here a lot for a couple different reasons.
My name is Pat Hagen. I work with Rusty and Nelson Beauvoorhees. And my background, I was previously executive director of Friends of the Bay, which was an organization that's devoted to preserving and protecting water quality. So that's one of my areas of expertise. I develop comprehensive management plans, watershed management plans, and that's what I'm working with Rusty on, is developing the master plan folio. I also have a background in fundraising and development, so I'm kind of writing it and looking at it to give assistance to your development team.
So at this point, I think I'm going to ask if we could just take about 3 minutes just to buzz with the person next to you, just to talk a little bit, to say, I heard this, did you hear this, I have a question about this. Sometimes it just helps you to gather your thoughts, because the next part of the meeting is the most important part. This is the part where we're going to ask you to really ask questions, as many questions as you have, give suggestions, and also give some caution. Many of you have history of working here on this property and being here a long time, and you might be able to say to me, you know, Karen, 20 years ago, we looked at doing this and ABC. We need to hear that too. So that's really why we wanted to have a diverse group here today. So just 3 minutes, talk to the person next to you. What are you hearing, concerns, questions? What do you think we forgot?